Good morning. Good to see everybody this morning. And if you're here this morning, if you'll get your hymn books out and turn to 156, we're going to be singing out of the Methodist hymnal this morning. 156.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome you into your Father's house. It's always good to be able to come home. It's also a welcome we extend to those who would be joining us through some medium, wherever you are and whatever's going on in your life. It's always good to come home. Today's a strange day. You get up and you hear about where storms have landed and warned about them coming. Prepare. I can remember as a boy having to tend to livestock, and they have to be tended to no matter the weather. And it was always good to be able to come home. get into the house before the storms hit, or even in the midst of them. Storms come in all kind of fashions. They come to everyone's life. If you don't have a home, if you need a home, I couldn't offer you a better one than Old Bethel. We gather here every Sunday morning at 9:30. Come and be with us. Again, welcome.
Thank you, Brother Wayne. We're going to get back into our worship service and song this morning. Our next hymn is hymn number 368. 368. Number 454. Open my eyes that I may see. 454.
Silently now,
At this time, if our ushers will come, we'll receive this morning's offering. Let's remain standing for our praise song this morning before we turn it over to Brother Wayne. And our praise song this morning is in the celebrational hymnal, so we're going to have to switch over. It's a great song. It's called Worthy of Worship. It's on page 153.
Thank you.
This time we're going to turn it over to Brother Wayne for this morning's message.
Worthy of worship and praise. That's a pretty song. I've never heard that one. Thank you for that. I always hate to butcher a song. You know, if I don't know it, I don't know it. That's it. All them little squigglies are wasted ink with me, but the Lord inspired someone to pen those words and to put them to music, and just seems like a shame to me to butcher it. But anyway, it was a beautiful song. Thank you for that. Don't try, you don't learn. Worthy of worship and praise. Worthy of worship and praise. Do you really believe that? I mean, we come to this place religiously. Before you get all happy about that, religious just means habitually. It doesn't have anything to do with God, or it's an adjective that means habitually. We come to this place. We started off today with I Love to Tell a Story. That's one of my favorite songs I grew up with. Worship, at its very core, if you could put it into a bowl and boil it, boil it and boil it and boil it and boil it till the pure essence of it was left there, would be remembrance. Remembrance. Worship is about remembering. The songs, the praise part of a worship service is so very, very vital and important. You are so very blessed to have Pam. I hope you tell her frequently. It's so difficult to stand at a pulpit and try to carry folks to a place when they've wandered all over everywhere. How in the world do you get them back together and then move them where you would like them to go? Songs of the faith do that for us, or they don't. I love to tell the story. You don't have a story to tell if you don't understand, if you don't let your very core believe that He's worthy of worship and praise. Now, if you've heard about Him and you've heard the story from somebody else, that's a plus. That's a good thing. But it usually doesn't move you to the point of worship and praise. It gives you some knowledge and you know how to behave comfortably around those who are engaged in worship and praise. But the effect of that is after a while people begin to believe that you are exactly like them, and then we send you out. But what happens, you don't really love that story. You know the story. You've heard it multiple times from other folks, but it's not your story. So it's not something that you relate. So you don't tell the story. And so nothing changes. Easter's not far away from where we are today, our celebration of that. We're going to read from Luke's gospel. I'll go ahead and tell you that. Chapter 24, we're going to begin reading at verse 13. And we are going to read through 49. 13 to 49. It's a lengthy reading, but we're going to get through that. We're going to read about afterwards, after the resurrection, after the crucifixion. You know, At some point in time, I hope that you have made a decision. You have willfully chosen to commit your life to the Lord, to Christ, to Jesus. Now, we use all kind of different languages. It usually comes from our background, what we grew up around, the way we heard it, the way we talked about it, the way others talked about it. You surrendered, you got saved, you were born again, you got washed in the blood, on and on and on. As Methodist, we understand that that is a process that we at some point engaged. It's a little bit different than others. We don't believe that it's a one and done, you're lightning strike and you're good. We believe that it's something that will work in and through your life for the entirety of your life. If you have made that decision, that choice, what's happened since then? You see, we know about the story. Whether it's ours or not, we know about it. We know that he went to the cross, was crucified. We know that he had followers that had surrendered their lives to take up the life he offered. What then? What when they put him in the tomb? What when they got news that he had risen? These things are important because at some point in time, if you have accepted, if you've made that choice, if you've been saved, born again, washed in the blood, or as the Methodists would say, if you're in the process of being saved, God's still working on us. What then? What then? You see, our adversary in this life never tires, never weakens, is, according to God's own word, the most clever of all creatures. What then? Let's read the scriptures. I'm going to read to you from a New International Version of the Bible, the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 24. I'm going to begin reading at verse 13. I'm going to read through verse 49. As you're able, would you please stand for the reading of the gospel? Now, that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed, before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what's more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, 'How foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." My friends, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. But we had hoped. And there we are. We had hoped everything would be rosy and wonderful. Unfortunately, preachers too often paint a picture of life with Christ that is not realistic and not what most people find. Most people, I believe, have a very romantic view of life with Christ, life as a Christian. It's all about them. But if you understand that word Christ, the definition of which means the one who saves. So if you are a Christian, then you're the one who saves. It's not about you, it's about those that you will encounter along the way. Those you would encounter. But we had hoped. Where are you in your life? Easter is coming on. We've celebrated it again. Do you believe? These are men that walked and lived and talked and ate and listened to Jesus preach. And they had doubts. He said, "Look, see my hands? See my feet? Touch me." And they still had doubts. It was only after you ate something. How many times in your life, you know the story, you've heard it. I hope you have accepted it. I hope you have accepted God's offer of life through his Son. A chance to go home. A chance to avoid all the storms of life and go to the safety of home with our Father. But have you then doubted? You see, we live in a time where, unfortunately, a lot of preachers kind of take the Trump view, or the Trump. I don't even know how to say it. You know, I heard this morning they were talking about this fake news. Fake news, fake news, fake news. Oh, we're not fake news. We're not fake news. Well, let me see. If what you report is not true, it's fake. It's either the truth or it's not. Unfortunately, people stand behind pulpits such as this with a Bible somewhere around and preach fake gospel. It's either the truth or it's not, and if it's not God's word, it's not necessarily the truth. If you parse and separate and pick and choose and string together some words that are in the Bible, they are yours, they're not God's. And people have been deceived. So we don't necessarily love to tell the story. We're most often afraid to tell the story. What if somebody questions it? You know, when I was preparing to go before the committee for ordination, it's an interview process, and you have to write and answer these historic questions, and you go before them. You have no clue what they're going to ask you. So I was ready. You know, one of the biggies with Methodism is infant baptism. How do you explain infant baptism? How do you explain Holy Communion? Consubstantiation, transubstantiation? How do you differentiate? What do they want to hear from you? Got there, and the first time I went through the dual ordination, deacon and then elder. The first time, guy kept asking me these weird questions, and I had prepared myself. My undergrad's in psychology, so I was employing everything I had to try to figure out, what does this guy want to hear? And his questions made no sense. So one of the tactics that you learn, if people really want to tell you what they want to hear from you, so I would kind of fold his question back and repeat it back to him. So what I hear you saying is that you would like me to blah, 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 blah. Every time he'd add a little bit more to it. He finally just, I had a breakthrough. He finally just blurted out, what I want to know is, are you going to do what the bishop says? I said, oh, so you want to know, do I respect authority? I had to tell him, look, my father is a retired Mississippi Highway Patrolman. I probably know more about respecting authority than any preacher in the conference. That satisfied him. But the shock to me, it had absolutely nothing to do with the gospel. Not anything. Nothing. You're going to let a preacher be ordained and send them out without questioning them about the truth. The second time I went up, I was better prepared and more at ease. And one of the questions is, what do you see as the greatest hindrance to the furthering of the gospel today? And I put, well, you know, the total depravity of humankind. Oh, that mistake. That's Calvinism. I said, I rest my case. I rest my case. We think that we are so good that God ought to be glad to take us. We don't busy ourselves with trying to learn the truth, the gospel, God's word. What does it mean for us? So lo and behold, we get out here into the world, we claim the name of Christ, we tell people if we're asked what church we go to, We keep the story to ourselves. We either don't know the story, or we don't understand the story, or we don't believe the story. Or we're so afraid, we're so ill-equipped to share the story that we let doubt silence us. Of course, you run into those folks, if you say anything about doubt, oh my goodness. There's nothing wrong with doubt. They walked and talked, ate, slept, listened to Jesus. He's standing there showing them the nails marks in his hands, his feet. He said, reach out and touch me, and they still didn't believe. We are human beings. We are going to doubt. We're not saved by our knowledge. We're saved by our faith. Do I understand how God rolled away a stone and brought back to life? Not created new life, brought back to life his son? No, I do not. Now, my wife answered the question that way, and they didn't accept that either. But the rest of that answer is, but I put my faith in it. I don't have to have all the answers. God asked me to put my faith in his son and let him do everything else. The beautiful story, the wonderful story that we should love to tell, the thing that should move us to worship and praise God is that in our sin, in our iniquities, in our doubts and our failures, God loves us enough to bring us home, and he's made a way. Prayer lists. I don't like prayer lists because Jack hit the nail on the head. Somebody's written it down, and it was read at church, so it's out of our mind. We don't worry about it. Take it home and read it. Think about them. We talked about folks that are here, and we've talked other times about things that are going on. We talked about Tom and Linda and Johnny this morning. They got stuff going on, big stuff, serious stuff. God is with us. That's what Emmanuel means. God is, not God might be or could be, or we hope that he is. God is with us. What does that mean for you and I? It means that we should so love that story. It should be the greatest story that we've ever heard, and we couldn't wait to share it with other people. Whatever happens in every life here, I promise you, God has made a way for it to be all right. God has already made a way. And he has invited you and us to live into that grace, that peace, that presence. It's so hard for us when we're approached by folks that might question our faith. We're Methodists. We don't question people's faith. You know, what they believe has no bearing on what we believe. It doesn't threaten our faith, so we don't go around saying, well, you know, you're wrong. There's no gain in that. We have a story to tell, not something to defend. We have a story to tell. God loved us enough that he sent his only begotten son, that whosoever calls on his name, not might or can hope, but shall be saved. So whether it's Miss Upel, Tom, Linda, Johnny, you, me, I can tell you the end of this story. even in the midst of our doubts. And if you don't have them, you're either stupid or you're lying. It's going to be all right. Now, we don't like it because we don't know what it's going to look like or what it's going to take to get there. Thank goodness. Thank God. What a mess we would make. The story is that it's about God. It's not about me and it's not about you. He's invited us to live into that kind of a life where it's not about us, it's about others. And it's when we begin to engage that we really begin to understand life. Miss Shelley's not here, so I can talk about her. She asked for prayer for tomorrow because her state tests are tomorrow. You understand that request? She's not having to take the test. But those children are. Toothache, no toothache, it's coming. And her concern, if you hadn't figured that out, is her ability to be completely there with them. It's when we begin to put our life into the life of others that we truly begin to experience life. The story is the world did all it could. The evil one, the one that comes against us, our adversary, did all that he could. You know, when we talk about the birth of sin, we like to talk about it. You know, it was that woman. She did this, she did that. But when we talk about the devil, we seem to forget that it's always he did this, he did that. When he had done all that he could, God showed us the rest of the story. His word is good. Jesus did something here in this that Luke has recorded that we need to hear. This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. A lot of fake gospel preaching goes on, and you know, Old Testament doesn't mean anything. You better tear that page out of your Bible right here then. That's the story. Over and over and over and over and over of doubt, of betrayal, and rescue and grace by God. Grace isn't a new thing. God's given us grace all the way. So that story that we should love to share is about that grace. Grace. You received it so that you could offer it. You need to be busy. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this day, for this word, for the grace that you've shown us. Give us the courage, the understanding to share that grace with all that we encounter. In Jesus' name. Amen. So we turn to our closing hymn. Wherever you are in your life, if you've not known the love of God, if you've never committed, surrendered, been washed in the blood, saved, however you've learned to talk about that, I'd be afraid to go home without changing that. And you have that opportunity today. If you'd like to pray, please come and pray. If you'd like someone to pray with you, if you'll lift a hand, some of us will. Otherwise, it's not going to bother you. If you need to make a decision, choose God. If you need to find a church home, couldn't offer you a better one than this. Please come as we sing. Hymn number 512. Hymn number 512. Thank you. in peace may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit go with you always. Amen.